PNP Chief General Benjamin Acorda Jr. is seeking a clarification from Malacañang over the decision of President Marcos to accept the courtesy resignation of 18 officials allegedly involved in the illegal drug trade. ABS-CBN correspondent Raya Capulong joins us on the line for the details of that. Raya?
Ron, PNP Chief General Benjamin Acorda Jr. said they will wait for the official copy of the document in connection to President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. accepting the resignation of 18 third-level officers of the PNP who are allegedly involved in illegal drug activities before he makes a decision. According to Acorda, he is requesting a meeting in Malacañang to clarify things. Acorda said that it is possible for the 18 police officers to face criminal and administrative cases, and some of these names have already faced charges based on the recent investigation by the SITG. Acorda added that the officials whose resignations were accepted are being continuously monitored. Ron?
Raya Capulong with that story. Thanks for that. Now, in related news, senators are one in saying police officials with supposed drug links or those involved in irregularities should be held accountable. Senate Majority Leader Joel Villanueva says these officers must be charged in court. He maintains resignation is not enough. Senator Francis Escudero agrees, adding that slapping appropriate cases should be the next logical step. Senate Minority Leader Aquilino Pimentel III and Senator Ramon Revilla Jr. both say the police investigation and gathering of evidence must continue.
The Philippine government is aiming to complete its nuclear energy roadmap before the end of 2023. An official from the Energy Department says they're reviewing what will be required to harness nuclear power. Katrina Domingo joins us on the line with details. Kat?
Hi, Denise. The Nuclear Energy Program Interagency Committee is in the process of reviewing 19 infrastructure issues in developing nuclear power, including nuclear safety, grid infrastructure or connectivity, safety, and as well as spent fuel management. That's according to Energy Assistant Secretary Maylene Capongcol, who spoke to reporters on the sidelines of the post-SONA 2023 forum at a hotel in Pasay City. She says the government needs to study carefully and that there should be transparency in the site selection as well as public perception, which in fact the government will be conducting a survey to measure the public perception or the acceptance of the public with regard to the Philippines having its own nuclear program. Now, Denise, as you mentioned earlier, the roadmap is expected to be finished or completed before the end of the year. She says, or rather, the assistant secretary says, aside from the possible reopening of the Bataan nuclear power plant, the DOE is also looking at smaller nuclear reactors that can be used to produce nuclear power for the Philippines. Among the considerations is the price, because we all know that it's a new technology and that most of it are under demonstration and are not yet commercially available. This is also why that the assistant secretary could so far not provide a ballpark figure as to how much the Philippine government needs to shell out for each small nuclear reactor. Denise, the DOE says they are also closely coordinating with legislatures to come up with a law that will establish the nuclear energy program in the Philippines, especially after President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. stated in his second State of the Nation address that his administration is working to fully electrify the Philippines by 2028. Now, Denise, before we end, just some context for our viewers. The DOE earlier mentioned that the Philippines needs to have an additional 8,000 megawatts of available power in the next 5 years, and the country is expected to increase its peak demand to 25,000 megawatts from the current 17,000. Denise.
Thanks for that, Kat. Now let's get an update on the situation in Batanes. We have on the line Justin Jerico Sosito, Provincial Administrator and Information Officer of the Batanes LGU. Justin, thank you for joining us.
Hello po. Good evening, Ma'am Denise and all your viewers.
Good evening. Justin, we'd like to ask, how's the current situation right there?
As of now, we are experiencing moderate winds and light rain, so we're no longer experiencing the strong winds unlike last night and earlier this morning. But so our personnel are already on the ground conducting initial assessment as to the extent of damages of this Typhoon Egay to our province. Unfortunately, we have no reports yet of damage to infrastructure and properties. But as per our initial ocular assessment, the damage is more on our agricultural sector.
So how about any reported casualties or missing people?
We do not have any report as to casualty or injured individuals and even missing people. But we have 37 individuals or 11 families who are in our evacuation center. They volunteered to be evacuated yesterday because of their because they worry about their houses that are made of light materials. But nonetheless, we do not have any casualty, we do not have any injured, and we do not have any missing people.
You know, that's a relief here, Justin. I know you mentioned that right now there's already moderate rains. Do you see these families coming back to their homes by tonight or tomorrow morning?
The concerned municipal governments are not yet allowing them to return to their respective houses. So we are expecting them to return to their homes tomorrow morning. The earliest will be tomorrow morning.
Okay, Justin Jericho Sosito, Provincial Administrator and Information Officer of the Batanes LGU. Justin, take care.